Okay, so Simon told us about how good Medicare for All would be compared to our current employer-based insurance. That all sounds good, so why don't we just jump on it? Well, because there is this myth that it will cost way too much and we can't afford it. So that is the myth that I am stuck with, convincing you that it is not true. Well, I want to start out by convincing us that we have a problem. Houston, we have a problem. This slide depicts the proportion of our economy that we are spending for the healthcare industrial complex. And you can see that in general, it is a upsliding trend, and it does not give us any indication that it wants to sort of level off and maybe go down. That's a big part of our $18 trillion economy in the United States of America. $3.7 trillion we're spending for healthcare needs. That might be really good if we're getting a lot in return for our investment, but it is a problem because there are other things we need to do in our economy besides pay for healthcare. I mean, we have roads to build, we have education to provide. Unfortunately, we spend a lot of money on military, but there are many other things that we need to do with our economy. And if we keep using more and more and more simply for feeding the healthcare industrial complex, you can see it's not going to go to a good point. And that slide says that we are close to, well, 1 year ago, close to 18%. And within a couple of years, we will be spending as much as 20% of our gross national product on healthcare. So that's the problem, or it is a problem. Let me take you to another perspective. We have a natural experiment that has occurred. In our country, you can see the slope of the increase of our expenditures. But just to the north, our Canadian neighbors also are watching their gross national product expenditures go up. But it's a different curve than ours. So what is the difference? So back in the early 70s, we had one of our attempts to control healthcare expenditures, and that was under the Nixon administration, and we introduced the HMO Act. But unfortunately, the insurance companies managed to grab a hold of the HMO Act and continue to make lots of money for themselves, and it didn't really bend the curve. On the other hand, the Canadians at the same time implemented their Medicare Act, and you can see that it has been associated with a relatively lower rate of increase. So maybe there is something about the Canadian system. The reason I'm showing you this is because the Canadian system is a single-payer system. So this is a comparison between a country with a single-payer system and our country with a multitude of payers involved in the healthcare financing. When I first discovered this information about a year ago, it was a publication by Wohlhandler and Himmelstein, and I was just really astounded that we are spending so much more relative to other countries. Now, I don't think any of us, although we may not have traveled all that much, but I don't think any of us have to believe that these other countries that we're seeing here, Sweden, Canada, France, that their healthcare product is that much different than ours. But certainly, those countries are expending per person much less, or almost half of what we're expending. But the other part that's really interesting is that if you consider our bar on the bottom, there's the blue part and the red part. The blue part of our expenditure is coming from public sources. The red part is what we're always talking about with employer-associated healthcare. But we're already, from public sources, expending as much as other countries are for their full healthcare cost coverage, except for Switzerland. And if they can do it, why can't we? that really raises a big question in my mind. So let's take a closer look at that proportion. So we consider that 35% of our healthcare costs are being covered from private insurance, employer-based in a lot of cases. So this would be investor-owned private insurance, and 65% of our healthcare costs are already being covered by public sources. And this is astounding. You say, well, where's that at? Well, let's look at it. So we have tax subsidies. So that means that the federal government provides subsidies to private employers who are paying for the employer-based insurance for their employees. So that's money that's not going into federal coffers. So in effect, economically or accountingly, it is a coverage. It's a write-off from the government. We also have benefits that go to all of our government workers at all levels. So if you have a city worker and they have insurance, the city is paying an insurance company to provide the insurance coverage, but that premium is coming out of public funds. And then, of course, the VA system is a huge provider of health care for veterans who, in general, speak very highly of the care that they receive. And then we also have other public sources, and for example, the Native American Indian resources and so forth also. Medicaid, we're all familiar with, and Medicare, we're all familiar with. So that's the pie. Two-thirds of it is already covered by public sources. So what is the problem? Why is it that if we are spending so much, we're not getting a return on our investment? Where is the hitch-up that between us, for example, and the Canadians? What I'd like to do here is show an increase in the number of physicians. Some people might say, well, we have more doctors in our country. But let's just see what happens. If we look at the growth of physicians, it's kind of hard to see because of the scale, but maybe the number of physicians in our country since 1970 to 2015 have doubled. And that makes sense because medicine is more complicated, it takes more expertise, and I think in general we would be happy to know that we have twice as many physicians operating today than we did 35 years ago, or 50 years ago, actually, I guess. But look at this growth. So those are the managers, and this would be, I think, one indicator of where all of our resources that we're expending is going. And why do we have so many managers in our system? Because private insurance is very busy looking for ways not to pay the benefits to those that have paid the premium. And this is where you have a lot of grind going on that's not providing care, but it's arguing over who has to pay for care. And that's one evidence of the inefficiency. So I will argue that our current system needs to be fixed. It is on a growth curve that is not showing any indication of leveling off. So our choice is either we ration care, so some people get it and some people don't. That's one way of controlling the rising cost. And that's one thing we're already doing. Simon alluded to the fact that we have 10% of our population not even covered. And so that's one way of reducing our costs. The other way to reduce our costs is to make our system more efficient. And that means we have to get rid of the dead weight. And those are the profiteers, the people who are making benefit out of our need for health care, and go to a single payer system that can be much more efficient and achieve the goals that we need. Thanks.